This is wonderful to be here, part of this meetup, and thank you so much for joining for this meeting. I'm Harshal Hayat Nagarkar. I will quickly introduce myself. I'm the lead computer scientist with ThoughtWorks Engineering for Research. I look after the R&D engagements and also guiding the people, the teams on working on the projects, as well as getting their work published in prestigious conferences and journals. And it was my host, the co-host Chhaya, to introduce herself as well.
Hello, good morning, good evening. I'm Chhaya. I'm from Pune, India. I'm the delivery partner for engineering for research, and I pair with Harshal. I'm also project manager for 30-meter telescope project that runs out of the Pune office in India. I'd also like to share one information that in India, being a Thursday, we may experience power cut. So sometimes Harshal and I may not be audible for a minute. So just bear with us till we switch our mobile networks and get back online. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, that's useful. I hope you can see the screen. And with confirmation, I will proceed.
Yes, it looks great.
Thank you. Okay, so engineering for research is a relatively new initiative started by ThoughtWorks. Currently, it is running mostly through India, and it is the initiative to advance computational sciences. So you might have heard computer science. You may be wondering what is computational science. So computational science is the way computational methods are applied in sciences, for example, computational astronomy, computational biology, computational epidemiology, and so on. So this is the initiative to contribute to computational sciences. So we have three active engagements. We have many active, but these are the three main projects or active engagements. And you might have already heard about 30-meter telescope, the largest optical telescope being built in the United States. And it is a consortium of five countries, India being one of them. And we are currently collaborating with Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore, which is the nodal agency or the representative agency from India side. And what we are working for TMT is to build the control system software, the common services necessary to operate the telescope, along with user interfaces and some data management. And this is one very exciting project that you will hear more details in this session, as well as later on, there will be a separate session as part of this series. The second engagement that we have is for the largest radio telescope being built, it is Square Kilometer Array. This telescope is being built, is hosted by two countries, Australia and South Africa. And it is another consortium. India is also one of the partner countries. And here we have been working with two agencies. One is Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics, which is in Pune. And we have been building for them a data processing pipeline. And the prototype version one has already been released, used, and the principal investigator, Dr. Gupta, has already made a discovery with that. And currently we are in the process of releasing version 2.0. Another agency, along with IUPA, we are working is TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Part of that is National Center for Radio Astrophysics. It is home of giant meter wave radio telescope. And we are working with them in order to advance the ultra-large scale data storage, use of machine learning, as well as accelerated computing for data processing. And this is some of the exciting that we have been doing. Along with that, with astronomy, we mid last year, started working on BharatSim. BharatSim is India's homegrown first ultra large scale agent based epidemic simulation framework. Even though we have started with epidemic simulation, the idea is to go beyond that to simulate economic and climate change research and policy making. This work is in collaboration with Ashoka University's Dr. Gautam Menon. And current focus is COVID-19 simulations. And these are the three large active engagements we have in engineering for research. I hope my audio and my pace of speaking is good. So how do we go to work engagements. These are not exactly client engagements. We call them as collaborations. So how do we collaborate? We try to identify a novel computational problem. Here, novelty is important in a sense. The work, whatever we do, needs to be publishable in prestigious conference or a journal. And in order to identify such a problem, we spend some time with the research organization or scientist or a team of scientists. And that could take some time. So roughly a month we spend. Thereafter, we engage in a proof of concept in order to understand whether the problem is feasible, can it be solved by thought workers, whether it is within the purview of our skills, interests, and so on. And then once we pass that stage, we move towards working towards the actual solution. So this could take anywhere between 3 months to 6 months, sometimes even longer. And then thereafter, we work towards identifying the insights, what has been the contributions, and work towards the publication. And that could take another 1, 2, or 3 months, depending upon the nature of the publication. And thereafter, we look for some funding for sustenance. So we would like to keep this initiative a sustainable initiative. So that's how, you know, this is the mode of collaboration. So you may be wondering, you know, we are publishing in conferences and journals. We are working on computational science, but why engineering for research and what we call as E4R? But why do we have E4R in first place? So the answers to that is twofold, and in next couple of slides, I'm going to explain. The first one is that as a humanity, have we taken progress for granted? So be it discovering laws of nature, such as gravitational waves and or the nature of black holes or few new fundamental particles, as CERN is trying to do, for example, Higgs boson they discovered. Or it could also be synthesis, discovering new seeds that could be, you know, finding out crops that are more resistant to climate change, or discovering new materials. How can we make solar panels more efficient? Or discovering medicines, as we have seen, for COVID-19 vaccines, or telecommunication, moving from 5G to 6G, or computing hardware and software. We know that Moore's Law is fading. What kind of stuff we could do with computing hardware and software? So we imagine that progress will just happen. But it is not only about tangible things, it is also about policies. So health policies, or economic policies, such as equitable growth, or ecological policies, how can we minimize our impact on the nature, and educational policies, as we have seen in India. So it looks like while these are some of the important problems, at the heart of some of them, definitely, there are good high quality computational challenges, which could help us to grow intellectually. So with this, this is the, you know, primary motivation behind E4R. And based on this, we came up with two hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that there are some ambitious big science projects which face computational challenges at par or perhaps greater than those faced by the internet giants in their infancy. So what made Google Google, or what made Yahoo or Amazon? If we could get access to such challenges, we also would get a chance to grow intellectually. So this is basically, you know, we get access to the challenges, but what do we bring to the table? We bring to the table some of the advances in computer science and software engineering that the world has seen in the last 20, 25 years, be it the progress that has happened in dealing with large scale data in terms of big data ecosystem, or the machine learning ecosystem, which has given the data driven or learning based approaches, or it could be new mobile computing, UI, UX kind of practices. It could make it easier for scientists to interact with the data overall. Managing the processes of dealing with data. Or it could also be the software engineering practices. It can be as something as simple as version control, or it can be something as more sophisticated as continuous delivery for machine learning. So we bring a lot of ideas to the table. So if we get access to these problems and we could contribute to the scientific organizations in their own pursuit, this is the overall vision for E4R, is to build a community that is kind of exclusively working with research organizations for building tools for scientific exploration. And this community is, you know, comprises of academicians, engineers, scientists, And what we would like to do is to discover computer science of Horizon 3. So what is Horizon 1, 2, 3? This is borrowed terminology, but I think it is very well applicable here as well. So Horizon 1 is business as usual. It is known paradigm. The problems are known, the solutions are known. You need to apply the solution one more time to the problem. So for example, building the web app or building a mobile app, you know how to do that, we excel that multiple times. Now we need to do it one more time. Horizon 2 is known challenges. So here problems are known, very well articulated. The solutions may not be known or they may not be sufficient. And that's how Horizon 2 problems or that space is defined. Horizon 3 is unknown paradigm. We don't even know what we don't know. And these are something like new frontiers. So an example to give could be, what should be the programming abstractions for quantum computers or for DNA computers? Or what kind of mechanisms or methods we need in order to manage a million drones, for example? Or what kind of methods do we need in order to optimize efficient planetary exploration? If we were to look at some of these problems. So these are unknown territories, and computer science also has some of its own problems. So what scientists try to do is to understand how the nature works. And that's, they are in the business of understanding the nature. And nature is complex. So what is the complexity here? So I can give an example. Complexity or complex systems in general, they show some novel properties or behaviors that are called as emergent properties or emergent behaviors. So for example, neurons in individual neurons in our brain, they do not carry any intelligence, but when they are connected together, the identity emerges, the concept of I emerges. Similarly, the idea of thoughts emerge, and these are the emergent phenomena, concept of consciousness, intelligence, all the emerge. So how this is connected to the physical world? So if someone asks me, what am I made up of? My answer could be atoms. So I'm made up of atoms, which is correct answer. I can also say I'm made up of cells, and that is also correct answer. So depending upon the abstraction that you choose, it could very well be the compartment in which we are looking into. Right. But we know truly that it's one continuum, everything made up of atoms. So this compartmentalization, that something is physics, something is chemistry, something is biology. Of how physics turns into chemistry, turns into biology, something, the compartmentalization and the whole nature emerges. And what we try to understand is how this micro to macro connections, they give rise to what is called a multi-scale emergence, and that could be ad infinitum, bottom down as well as bottom, top down as well. So there are some drivers of complexity, and this is a paper that I wrote in 2018. How scale, diversity, network, and dynamics, these four things, they contribute to complexity of nature. So how do scientists analyze nature? There are four ways. But the first one, obvious one, is to understand by observation. So this is the Galileo telescope that Galileo built in around 1610, and he used to observe the sky. And as we see over 400 years, the telescopes have become complex. So you see on the right hand side, the European Southern Observatory is a very large telescope, actually. And this is currently the largest optical telescope that started in 1998. We can see the advancement of science. But the way Galileo was taking notes, as you can see, based upon these notes and later observations and analysis, he discovered that Jupiter has four stars that are closely moving around it, and he concluded these must be Jupiter's moons. For the last 400 years, the note-taking mechanism had changed to something like this. So this is the data grid, famous data grid at CERN, and now instead of writing, scribing with hands, now you record everything by using sensors and dump the data after acquisition with such data grids. Now it is obvious that you need to analyze this data and discover the insights, such as Galilean moons of the Jupiter. How do you do that? The biggest problem that people often are encountering nowadays is the data volumes are growing. So large Hadron Collider, for example, has close to 400 petabytes of data collected over its lifetime. The SCAR radio telescope will generate data in equal to entire internet's traffic on that day when completed. And it is hypothesized that next generation DNA sequencers will even break these barriers. So the question is why this is happening. It's happening because we are adding more sensors of different variety of higher resolution or sensitivity. So we, for example, in mobiles, we know that we started with sub-megapixel cameras and now we are close to 100 megapixel cameras. So which means that the resolution and sensitivity is increasing. We are also conducting more experiments and we are extracting more samples per unit time. So if you are sampling analog data at 1 millisecond versus if you are sampling at 1 microsecond, you get a 1000-fold increase because of that. So it is not only physical sensors which are adding to the data volumes, there are also simulations, which are virtual experiments conducted using computational models, and also humans. So why humans? Because Facebooks and other social media of the world, they collect human data, and then this data is analyzed to understand human behavior or the collective behavior of a group. But while this is happening, the ability to process the data is not going at the same speed. So because of fading of Moore's law, you do not see that the ability to process the data is kind of plateauing now, which means the gap is increasing and it is growing non-linear. So once these data volumes are growing, what scientists would like to do is process this data, and it can be empirical or hypothesized. And then based upon that, you build nature models. And that's where the role of computers is visible. And these nature models, of course, they can be empirical and hypothesized. So how do we build these nature models using computational science? So this is an increasing scope of computation. The terminology what I have used in these concentric circles or the circles is computational terminology. So you have expressions, algorithms, and then systems models that use of perform some data mining and so on. So this is again a continuum as represented by the blue arrow. And generally, I try to explain this using a running example of the great Irish famine of mid-1840s or mid-19th century. It happened so that a fungal infection entered from Americas into Ireland. And that fungal infection started affecting potato crops. So by that time, potatoes had become staple food of people. And those there had been kind of reliance on substantial reliance for food supply. So the way this potato crop started failing because of this infection, it resulted into sort of famine and deaths and population contraction in general. And people started moving out of Ireland. People tried to get into UK, that was blocked. Tried to get into Canada, that was also blocked. And eventually people entered the United States, and there a generation or a couple of generations after, child of a Irish family founded Ford Motor Company, Henry Ford. So now if we consider two disparate points in the timeline, one being that fungal infection entering Ireland, and another one, Ford Motor Company founded by an Irish immigrant. These are very far apart points. It is not easy to connect them, but you can imagine a framework, and perhaps such a framework would be useful that presenting. This is an evolving understanding that we have in Quran, but more or less it is still. So let me walk you through what these circles try to tell us. So expressions are kind of, you can think of them as static, behavioral models which do not carry any of the dynamics. You can represent them using either statistics or calculus or linear algebra, system of equations, and so on. And then they act as the fundamental or they act as building blocks or the fundamental laws of the system that you would like to understand or build. But there is, because there is no dynamic associated with it, you would like to add some dynamics. It could be a spatial dynamics, or a temporal dynamics, so space or time. And algorithms can give you dynamics of single behavioral model. And you can also use algorithms to analyze the data generated by the dynamic. And here the nature of the algorithms could be serial or parallel or distributed or nowadays accelerated and so on. And here the notion of dynamical systems start emerging. You can start analyzing that. Now, this dynamics of one behavioral model can be connected with dynamics of another behavioral model. And that's where you get systems modeling, network dynamics and so on. And that's where you also start seeing some interesting applications of systems engineering. And you perhaps could need graph theory for analysis and design of such systems. So if I were to map these three circles to the famine example, Irish famine example, the concept of mutation, how a random mutation works, can be captured as an expression. How a particular mutation manifests itself in physiology can be associated with an algorithm. So that is the dynamics. It could be a spatial dynamics, temporal dynamics, or spatio-temporal dynamics. But then you may want to understand how this dynamics of a mutation is interacting with a potato crop. That's where you may want to put these two things together, the fungal infection as well as the potato crop, in an integrated model using systems dynamics or systems modeling. And that's where you may want to understand how it is working. Now, this data, when you run across different types of mutations, you may want to understand which of those mutations would be interacting in what way. That's where you may want to understand the patterns or the anomalies that emerge out of such interaction of different models. And this is where data management, metadata management, lineage, data mining, all these start becoming visible. But not all mutations or their manifestations would be devastating. So which was, if we were to find out which of those mutations was devastating enough, you need to find out that using something called as constraint optimization. So you may need to try out lots of mutations, hypothetically. And then you need to define a criterion which will do the selection for you. So that model selection mechanism using some constraint optimization could be useful. And then finally, you may want to understand how the agriculture, monoculture practices in those days it affected. For example, when crops started failing field after field, year after year, people realized that there were monoculture practices. So what is monoculture practice? You sow potato crops one after another. There is no intermediate crop between that could stop the progress of that infection. So now you want to understand all of these things along with geopolitics. And that's where you try to connect everything together. The artificial boundaries of physics, chemistry, biology, sociology, geopolitics, all they could start disappearing. And you may want to create a multi-scale, multi-path model, a transdisciplinary model, whereby there are no artificial compartments of the disciplines. And that's where we are heading. So we don't know what the future would look like, but currently, as we understand, transdisciplinary science is the way today's science is. So I hope this is something that I could explain it to you within the constraints of the time. So now, given that we definitely see that the nature is complex, it is multi-scale, but the way by which nature data or nature models are built is also complex. There is complexity of modeling. We know software is complex. So when you try to combine these two complexities, it is not easy for scientists to build such models for the data. So how do scientists practice the scientific method? So this is the only method of doing science. It is systematic, like all the steps and phases are clearly articulated. Here you have to explore it because there are some local loops that you could explore. There are four ways of doing science. The first one is observations and experiments, as Galileo or Newton did. The second one is theory building, where you try to imagine thought experiments and you perform thought experiments and you ask some questions. And then you build theoretical frameworks, as Einstein did. So when he asked question, what happens if I sit on a photon? And then he could see that there are some interesting questions emerging. Or the third way is computer simulation. So you can hypothesize a computer model, then try out different experiments, virtual experiments, and accordingly, it could give rise to a lot of interesting what if and if what scenarios you could come up. And the last way is data intensive computing, which is somewhat unification of all these things about, and that is also called as the fourth paradigm of science, which we are currently witnessing. So in case of fourth paradigm of science, you collect the data and then you analyze it for patterns and anomalies and so on, and you let the data tell you the story. Now, in this fourth paradigm, which is unified one, it is critical to adopt computational tools, everything from control systems to data processing to collaboration and methods. Collaboration as in, there was a paper, I think, published in physics with 5,000 authors. So you can imagine if even 1% authors were actually writing the paper, 50 people, that itself is not easy to coordinate. So collaborations is difficult, and you can imagine the level of complexity in actually building a system that gave rise to the insights which gave way for the publication. Or similarly, methods need to be adopted. So an example of method could be, imagine you need to train a machine learning model for classifying galaxies, and you need to train it using so there are billions of galaxies, by the way, and you need to train it for 100,000 or a million galaxies. So now for that training, you need to label each galaxy for its type. So whether it is type B, spiral galaxy or spherical galaxy or so on. Now labeling, looking at the morphology or looking at the visible features of a galaxy, and then saying that it is a spiral galaxy or not, that itself could take a lot of time for manually to label them. And it is not possible for an individual, for a team. So that's where the idea of citizen science emerged, and where you outsource or crowdsource labeling to a group of people or large number of citizens who could be trained perhaps. So the nature of science methods is also changing. So when scientists are working on all these challenges, you can see they are clearly wearing multiple hats. We are asking them to wear even more hats. So they are first of all domain expert. A biologist needs to be a biologist, need to be an expert in biology first. An astronomer need to be first an expert in astronomy, and so on. In addition to that, they are many of the time mathematicians. They write papers, books. They also speak at conferences and so on. They also teach at universities, their academicians. But in addition to that, they also need to sometimes, and if you ask me, most of the times, sell their work, their proposals to the funding agencies in order to get the funding. They also, once they get the funding, they need to manage that funding. And that funding management, along with a group of people for a lab, makes them project managers. Also, how much money has gone out and how much money is left makes them accountant. We are asking more of them. We are asking them to be programmers, data scientists, and also systems designers. So in this case, is it really scalable to ask them to do all these things together? Of course not. So for example, this discussion has been happening in different forums. So Wired, for example, ran a story about how modern astronomers, they need to learn coding or left behind. That was very provocative title. But this is not just a popular science, popular technology site like Wired. Nature Biotechnology also ran similar articles. And there is a peer-reviewed paper that actually talked about what are the challenges that scientists are facing, at least in case of molecular biology. And this is a paper, famous paper that appeared in Nature, the error, where the numbers say that how many scientists are programming more. So 45% of the scientists have said that they are developing software more than what they were doing 5 years ago. Similarly, 38% of the scientists have spent more of their time in developing software. And then these numbers, 47% and 34%, say that they are not equipped to do that. So they are required to do more, but they are not equipped to do more. So this has some implications. And what those implications are, basically the quality of scientific software directly influences the quality of scientific outcomes. So if there is a bug in your software, there is a good chance that there is a bug in the science that you're practicing. And in the wake of data deluge, it is very difficult to scale up these computational tools for the scientific discovery. For example, you can't ask a scientist to not only write software, but also write software for modern multi-core processors or graphics processing unit and so on. We just need to ask for a problem. So this is a problem that some people have been analyzing and understanding. So US National Academy of Engineering presented 14 engineering grand challenges for 21st century. So these are the challenges for entire 21st century, next 100 years, for entire humanity. And the 14th one, which is engineer the tools for scientific discovery, is the underlying principle for E4R. So what does this say is that in the next century ahead, engineers will continue to be partners with scientists. So this is like a partnership. This is not exactly you build me something like this. So sometimes it is not known what to build and how to build. And this has to be co-exploration together, scientists and engineers. And we call this as an enabler challenge, because once you build tools for scientific discovery, those tools can be used perhaps for discovering new materials, say for solar panels, which is the first engineering grand challenge, or analyzing brain, which is one of the engineering grand challenges. So this is, once we are working on this particular grand challenge, there is a good chance that you could also contribute to other 13 grand challenges. So how this partnership is happening? So we typically see science and engineering as two separate disciplines. So what scientists do is they understand the nature, what engineers do is to build the system. So observe new phenomena and discover laws. Then engineers are supposed to apply these laws to design systems that will break the observational barriers, which would help us to observe new phenomena and discover new laws. And this cycle continues forever. But as we know, there wasn't a gap, that this gap has been perceived, and this gap is actually shrinking. This gap actually never existed. For example, when Galileo built his telescope, he built it himself. Or Newton, for example, or Sir William Herschel, and so many other scientists that built their own systems. And as Richard Feynman once said, there's plenty of room at the bottom for nanotechnology. If you try manipulating individual atoms, then the gap between science and engineering just disappears. And in that case, it's one thing. And that's the nanotechnology of the Feynman option. What ThoughtWorks is doing? ThoughtWorks intends to have a symbiotic partnership based upon the vision that I shared with research organizations via engineering for research. And we are a relatively smaller organization. So we would like to conserve our energies. And for that, we have identified six thrust areas. And these six thrust areas, they give a very good coverage on the scientific method, as you can see. So what these thrust areas are, so cyber physical systems is, you can think of them as old school SCADA system, control systems, distributed control systems and so on, or new scale Internet of Things and robotics. Why cyber physical? Because you can't really separately design cyber and the physical parts and later on fit them in each other. You need to develop them together. And that's why cyber physical systems gives you a message saying that you can't build a car first and then later on add computers and then add control system. You need to develop a control system for a car along with the car. Or you need to develop control system for a telescope when you are designing this telescope, and as we have seen in practice. And this is where you interact with sensors, actuators, controllers, and you extract data that you would like to analyze further. That's where data intensive computing, the second thrust area, comes into picture, which helps you to kind of take this data, use it in multiple ways. For example, you may need to pre-process it itself, or if it is a streaming data acquisition, then you may want to process the data as it is flowing in. And this is old school high performance computing as well as supercomputing. A new school, you can think of big data ecosystem, either streaming, stream processing or batch processing. And you can also use some of the advanced hardware such as graphics processing, GPUs, or field programmable gate arrays, FPGAs, or ASIC applications, basically. And based upon, and you also write a lot of algorithms. And now these algorithms, when they give rise to insights, you would like to keep track of what was the original raw data, what was the data that was derived out of it by pre-processing, and then what were the insights, and who processed it using what for what algorithm, and so on. So you may want to keep track of whatever is happening in data processing. And that's where the idea of linking these things together for later consumption becomes important. And the digital libraries, which is the discipline we have borrowed from the physical library, it helps you to keep in track of whatever is happening in this. So digital libraries can be imagined as a digital version of physical libraries, where you have a catalog and you have assets, and you try to keep the catalog and assets tangibly connected with each other in some big fashion. So the ideas such as data governance, data provenance, access rights, and all those things, they become important in this case. So digital libraries, some of the assets could be mathematical models or insights extracted from that. And with those mathematical models, you can perform virtual experiments. So why do you need to perform a virtual experiment? It is because when you can't observe a phenomenon, or if you can't perform an experiment, you need to make a simulation model or virtual experiment. For example, what happens when two black holes collide, or what happens when two neutron stars collide, or what happens when there is a new variant of COVID-19 in a society. So you can perform what if and if what based experiments or analysis of the data generated by that and understand the overall dynamics. And that's the scope of modeling and simulation. And lab informatics is something which is, you can consider as SAP or ERP for managing the show for a scientific organization. Everything that is under the roof of that scientific organization. It is managing resources of different types, the equipment, the computing resources, be it funds, knowledge, and also people along with the resources. So access control and so on can be all controlled with lab informatics. And artificial intelligence is basically to add smartness based upon the deductive reasoning, inductive reasoning, objective reasoning, or machine learning, data-driven approaches to each of those five thrust areas. So you can think of smart physical, cyber-physical systems, or smart data-intensive, smart digital libraries, and so on. And artificial intelligence can itself be used to figure out the patterns and anomalies in the data. And there is, this is an evolving understanding. So in order to make observations, you may need all six of these thrust areas. For example, you may want to know whether I can really make that observation or not, whether the equipment is capable of making that observation. So you need cyber physical system. But once you have made the observation, to think of interesting questions, you may not need cyber physical system. You may need, or you may not need lab informatics. You may need all other force areas. And this is how it gives a very good coverage of these areas at the site. So what are the work current collaborations that we are doing vis-a-vis these six thrust areas? So for cyber physical systems, we are building control system software for 30 meter telescope. And this control system is based on reactive principles. And that's where we are using some of the fancy actor based models, Scala program, some cool stuff actually. We will hear about this particular work in one of the following sessions. This, along with that, we are also working on data intensive computing for SCAR radio tools. There we are doing data processing. We are building data processing pipelines. We are also trying to apply accelerated. For digital libraries, we are building a large scale data management system for TMP. Along with that, we are also currently in discussion for a similar system for star radio using object storage and so on. Modeling and simulation front, we are working on Bharat Sim, India's first ultra large scale agent-based simulation. Even though we are currently working on epidemic simulation, the idea is to improve beyond that. Lab informatics, we are working on SCA Regional Science Center. So what is regional? This is something which is very interesting. I have spent at least like that. So SCA will generate a lot of data. It will be entire internet traffic. Say 100,000 petabytes per day or something like that. And this data cannot be stored completely. So you need to kind of process it on the fly and store only a fraction of it. Now this fraction of the data itself is going to be larger. So there is one suggestion that instead of storing all this data only at two, and it is not easy to, by the way, access the data at two hosting sites, Australia and South Africa. So it is proposed that each partner country should build its own data center, large data center, which is called as science center, because it is regionally for each partner country, it is called as regional science center. And a significant chunk of the data at the main hosting site will be shipped to these regional science centers. So for example, India is expected to build a regional science center, which will host close to 100 petabytes of data in the first year. And this is raw data. So you need to process the data and then it will generate more data, basically 2.5 times more data. You need to keep multiple copies of that data, process data, because you perform different experiments. So 100 petabytes can quickly grow to 700 petabytes of data. This is in the first year. Each year there will be additional data coming. So how do you, and then you need to also restrict the access, because the scientists who have requested the observation, they should get access for some amount of time, and then only it should become open for the rest of the community. So there are some restrictions, and those restrictions need to be managed. That's the whole idea of it. Regional Science Center, and we are seeing Regional Science Center as one example or one case study for lab. In addition to that, we are working with NCRA, National Center for Radio Astrophysics, Flame University, Savitribai Phule Pune University, on solving some of the problems astronomy, drug discovery, economics. So we have published few papers also in application of deep learning, for example. Similarly, we participated in this drug discovery hackathon organized by the government of India. And that is basically the accelerated drug discovery using AI. And we have moved from phase one to phase two now. Along with that, we also have a few self-initiatives. In case of cyber-physical systems, we are working on collaborative robotics. So collaborative robotics is basically the how the robots would interact with each other as well as with humans. So human-machine, human-robo interaction, robo-robo interaction, so on. And the idea is to apply these ideas in planetary exploration. So what happens if a space agency decides to send multiple rovers for planetary exploration, like to explore Mars? And some of these ideas we also intend to apply to disaster response, for example, search and rescue operations. We published a paper for planetary exploration last year. Similarly, we have been working on what is called as PERC, so Posit Enhanced Rocket Chip. It is a microprocessor design that we modified to replace the IEEE 754 floating point processing unit by something called as Posit processing unit. Posit is an alternative to IEEE 754 because it's with fewer bits you can get the same accuracy or better. And the rocket chip is a RISC-V microprocessor implementation coming out of University of California, Berkeley. So this work we published in an ACM conference, ISCM, last year. We are also, so before Bharat Singh started, we were working on a homegrown framework called as EPIRIST in modeling and simulation. And EPIRIST is an epidemic simulation implementation in RISC programming language. And this is again an agent-based simulation framework. But unlike Bharat Singh, this is focused only on epidemic simulation, but its main focus has been performance and robustness. And there we are already able to simulate 100 plus million agents. And this is already according to some people, the most scalable framework. Lab informatics, we have just started exploring what is called as YASCA, yet another scientific knowledge architecture, which is how different, this is sort of integration of digital libraries and lab informatics, how different processes and assets, they need to be integrated with each other in order to build the backbone for next generation scientific discovery process. And this is still work in progress. The YASCA trivia is that YASCA was an ancient Indian etymologist who published foundational etymology work almost like 800 BC or so. And in addition to that, artificial intelligence, we have started working on toxicology in 21st century challenge by, I believe, National Institute of Health. The challenge is about classification of biomolecules in a catalog or a database of toxicity database. And this classification needs to be automated using some technique, like using supervised technique, either use deep learning or some. So we have been working on this as well. These are some of the select publications when we have been working on either self-initiatives or publications. And you can see the work is published in ADAS, astronomy, and data software systems for 2020, winter simulation conference 2020, as well as some of the other conferences. And we also we speak at multiple conferences. So conference on complex systems, we spoke. GLEXC is Global Space Exploration Conference. Our talk was accepted there. Unfortunately, the conference itself got canceled. So last but not least, I would like to share that there are few, while working on E4R, we have identified two formidable or irreversible trends. These trends also have coincided till now with an annual event that we organize in E4R, what is called as E4R Symposium. And till now we have had three symposia. The first one was on data deluge challenge or trend. The second one was on complexity. The third one we had on AI. And that topic was interesting. Will AI ever win a Nobel Prize? That we concluded in October 2020. The next symposium we are planning to be on mitigation of fading of Moore's Law. According to Nobel laureates, Dr. Nissen Patterson, they have given a vision which they call as towards the new golden age of computer architecture. The idea is that in this symposium this year, we will explore what is the nature of the challenge, what could be the nature of this golden age. So these are the four formidable traits. That's it from my side. Thank you so much for your interest. And if there are any questions, we'll be happy to. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Harshal. Thanks also, Chaya. I see we have a few questions. Chaya's been doing a great job of answering them in the chat too, but there's one from Matt that I can read out to you now. And it's, are there some folks that work with the Julia language there? Maybe by beginning with the computational thinking MIT EDU approach to CS and IT? I know a lot of people from India are involved with it, and a lot of those concepts are present in the Julia ecosystem through different packages of code.
Yeah, we have had some experience with Julia. It was a few years back, but we are definitely willing to explore Julia because it seems like writing mathematical models and performing is really the niche that Julia excels. And for us in E4R, we would like to use the best tool that can solve the problem. So of course, Julia is also
Thank you. Great. We had some questions from Carlos and Matt, I think also about the collaboration from the side of ThoughtWorks, and which are partially answered. So, but from Carlos, the question was, how do you select what projects or collaborators to be involved with? And is it only for ThoughtWorkers on the beach or in their free time? And maybe for people joining are not familiar with the concept of the beach at ThoughtWorks too, so that might be interesting to explain a bit. Thanks.
So, yeah, I think, I think Chaya, go ahead.
Right, so maybe to the question of what we look when we select projects and collaborators is basically we are looking at a problem which is in the H2, H3 horizon. That's something that has been unsolved so far. That's one of the prime criteria. At the same time, we also look for alignment within the E4R thrust areas, the six thrust areas being cyber physical system, lab informatics, modeling, simulations. And at the same time, is there a possibility of a real A-star conference or a paper-worthy publication, IEEE kind of publication? Are we pushing computational boundaries? Are we coming out something which is future-focused, cutting-edge tech? So these are very high-level parameters that we look into. If a problem is already solved, there's something that is existing. E4R really does not want to get into that area, right? So we're very conscious of being in the H2, H3 space. Maybe Harshal, you can add more to it, you know?
Yeah, usually we look at the problem statement that the research team or the collaborator, potential collaborator, has shared with us. And I can give you one example. So if we need to build a data processing pipeline, that's a problem. If we need to build it for processing a terabyte of data is where it becomes interesting. And once we build it for a terabyte of data, then what we need is to reduce the time. So if we were able to do it in 24 hours, can we reduce it to say 12 hours or 6 hours? And that's where a lot of interesting ideas, common ideas, they start becoming visible. And nowadays, I can assure you that there is a lot of ask in data science, data engineering, machine learning space that the scientists would like to try out. So that's the generally the landscape in which we are.
Thank you very much. The next question is from Joshua. Besides these sessions, is there any other ways that thought workers outside of the dedicated team can engage with E4R?
Yes, they do form a part of our E4R ecosystem. We are always happy to hear them, understand how they can contribute. And I've just mentioned on the chat that Joshua, do reach out to me or Harshal or write to E4R. We can take this offline to see if there are any synergies and how we can collaborate or work or figure out a space where you can contribute, you know, anytime. Yeah.
It's exciting that we already have potential collaborators coming in through this session. Awesome.
Yeah, I should just announce quickly that yes, there is an email, e4r@thoughtworks.com. So do write to us. I should have announced it or mentioned it.
We can maybe put it in the chat also.
Yeah.
Thanks, Harshal. Great. The next question is for Gurpreet. I hope I pronounced your name acceptably. So the question is, are there any OSS projects that which are E4R-ish and have good community support for contributors?
Yeah, so that's right, Gurpreet. There are many projects, good projects that we also use in E4R. And it is not just E4R-ish, but so many projects which found, you know, which kind of tell that they are core E4R-ish as well. In addition to that, we have our own Ethereum part of the open source ecosystem. So one example I would like to give, a project which is not developed by us, but we heavily used it, and we would like to contribute to it sometime in the future. So that is called, that's in astronomy, we used it, namely CASA. So CASA is Common Astronomy Software Applications. And this suite of applications or framework is very common in radio astronomy, but suite is very complex also, and very slow also. We have been asked multiple times if we could contribute to that. So that, yeah, with one example. There are several other examples in other disciplines, in bioinformatics, in epidemiology.
Thank you. Right now, the questions that were in the chat have all been answered. If anyone has anything they'd like to, another question, please put it in the chat. And while I'm waiting, I just want to point out, just to remind everyone that this is an 8-session meetup series, and we have some great events coming up too, and we'll be sharing the dates of those too in the chat, so you have an overview. And if you're joining through via meetup, keep an eye out for future updates on those. And Harshal and Chaya, if you have anything you'd like, okay, Steffi has just put the line up in the chat. But if there's any final or any thoughts as we sort of wind down that you would like to share, please feel free.
Maybe I can just give you a sneak peek on the next two sessions. So the next one is on the 30-meter telescope. The team will talk about the motivation around this project, and it's been going on for 5 years with multiple streams and another 5 years in pipeline for a telescope that's going to be operational for next 50 years. So good challenging stories of how the tech stack is chosen and how the ambiguity around requirements is handled. Very interesting story around the 30-meter telescope in the next session. And post that, we have a session on life sciences where we've done some very interesting work in the area of antiviral peptides and drug identification. So hope to see you all soon on those interesting sessions as well.
And you can see, hopefully you can see my screen. These are the upcoming events. And this is the next one coming up on Thursday, the 25th of March. And how about questions? Does anyone have any additional questions? Okay. Let me stop. My multitasking is at its limit for the second. I see a question from Ajit. I hope I said your name okay. And it's, is there any plan to build required capabilities across ThoughtWorks under the E4R service line?
I'll probably try to answer it, that E4R is more of thought leadership and future focus. We do build capabilities in terms of what's coming up in this trust areas, the tech stack, contribute to a lot of tech radar. But if you mean capabilities in terms of people and teams, that's something that that's not our area of focus. But how do we share what we've done? So we reach out to markets, to demands, to OTPs, to tech principals, research sessions, sharing our stories, connecting with them. And that's how what we do in E4R is then kind of shared and contributed across ThoughtWorks. But in terms of building capabilities with people and trainings or stuff like that, it's not something that we are looking at it. We did have boot camps that we conducted before COVID hit. So we did have boot camps on collaborative robotics and many other sessions like accelerated computing for people in India. 2-day boot camps, 5-day boot camps of what we've been doing and stuff like that. But I guess with COVID, we haven't been able to continue on those. Maybe in future at some point we can start. But at the moment, that's how we are working. Maybe Harshal, you could add more, you know?
Yeah, so if I understood the question well, is to build required capabilities across ThoughtWorks. So E4R basically is not a capability building exercise. It could also help in that, but mainly in terms of thought leadership and challenge. Now, if I were to flip this question and ask it other way around, as you were saying that across ThoughtWorks, if people need to contribute to E4R, then what kind of plan do we have to build those capabilities? So that question also has more or less answered in terms of boot camps to share that knowledge. And if we find that it could be useful to record those sessions and share with larger audience, we could do that next time. And in addition to that, you are passionate about one of these 6 trust areas. Why not? Then in that case, we can help you with whatever we know, and yeah, we'll reach out to us. And that's, I think, a step towards building the capabilities.
Thank you for your answer. A question from Gurpreet. I guess the question really is, how can E4R, like staffing, happen in other countries? Why is India the only country? E4R problems are not India only.
Yes. I really would like other countries and offices to start thinking in this direction, and we are happy to help you with our secret sauce of how we did this. No, but definitely, I mean, it's an idea that India just started this because of the 30-meter telescope that came to us. So the history, the story goes is when we started with 30-meter telescope, we were interacting with a lot of scientists from this area in astronomy, basically. And while those interactions were happening, we did realize that there was such a big gap in what they were doing and how computational science tools and frameworks can help them accelerate. And I think that's where the seed was sown that can we do something like this, which can build tools and frameworks for research and scientific institutions. And that's how Engineering for Research actually started. So that's a little bit about how E4R actually came into being. So if you have something like that in your country, helps, you know.
Yeah, to add to that, I think there are some country-specific initiatives. That's how they get started. But eventually, if the idea is appropriately absorbed by other countries, other geographies, other offices, it could naturally or organically focus.
And I think these kind of meetups and sessions is one step in that direction, where we are now looking at how E4R can also be there in other countries. And there are a few people who ask, how can we be a part of E4R or contribute? So I think that's where these kind of sessions are another way. So we are looking at how we can also have collaborations beyond India for E4R, you know.
Thank you both for answering. Okay, it looks like the questions are winding down. So I'll give it a second in case something comes up, but I just want to thank everyone so much for joining today. It's great to see people from all across the world. Thank you, especially to Chaya and to Harshal for a fantastic talk and a start to this series, which I'm really looking forward to. So yeah, thanks everyone. But yes, and if this, okay, I'm seeing no more questions then. But so again, thank you so much.